Welcome. Last time I gave you some history and also introduction into random matrices. In particular, what do we want to know about random matrices? Of course, the main thing is we want to understand the behavior of the eigenvalues, and the basic result is Wigner's semicircle law, for which I showed you also some histograms at the end. And that's of course something which first we have to formulate in a mathematical language, and then of course we have to prove it. That's one of the first the things which we want to do in the coming weeks. And so recall, so of course what essentially we want to prove is to see that the histograms of typical realizations of our random matrices converge to this semicircular shape. And so, I mean, mathematically, this means essentially that we have to see that the number of eigenvalues which are sitting in interval converge to the corresponding integral over the semicircle for this interval. Which means that we should see that typically characteristic functions of intervals, let's say for some interval from S to T, applied to our eigenvalues, summing over all eigenvalues. So this just means counting how many eigenvalues do I have in this interval. So this should converge to the corresponding integral with respect to the limit distribution, which is the semicircle, and of course we will describe it later a bit more precisely, that we have this kind of convergence in a almost sure or generic sense. We will say more about this later. Good. But the problem is, I mean, that's what we really want to see. That's what we see in the histograms. But proving this is not very straightforward. It's not so clear how we should do this, because this would mean essentially we would have to know the eigenvalues. Okay. And so, I mean, what I told you last time is that what we are going to do is to replace these characteristic functions by other functions. So what we really are going What we are looking here at essentially is the sum, but here we have functions of our eigenvalues, and this should converge if n goes to infinity, the size of our matrices, to the corresponding integral over the function f with respect to this limit distribution. Okay, and in principle, we would like to see this for characteristic functions, but what we are going to do is to show it for polynomial functions, or for powers. And I told you that if we know it for all powers, this is equivalent to knowing it for all this. Of course, this is not straightforward, and later we have to talk about this, so why this is the case. But this is, in our situation, the case. So this means that instead of choosing characteristic functions for all intervals, we look at functions of this form. Because then what we get here is just moments of our guy. And of course, also on this side, we get something which we can deal with much, much more easily. And I will say a word about this. I mean, maybe at the moment it's not clear why is this better than this. So if we do this, then of course what we are going to do is we take here the power, so we take here let's say the nth power over all our eigenvalues, and we have to see that this converges to the corresponding nth power integrated with respect to the semicircle, which of course is nothing else than the nth moment of the semicircle. Good, and that's what we really want to show. And then later, I will tell you why this is equivalent to the other one. Good, but maybe the first question is, why is this better than the characteristic function? And this is the case because this quantity can also be expressed in terms of the entries of our matrix. I mean, at the moment, of course, we are interested in the eigenvalues, but it's very hard to calculate the eigenvalues, so it's very hard to say something directly. What we know is something about the entries, because that's how we produce our matrix. We say the entries are plus minus one, and so, I mean, we know a lot about the entries. And so the question is, why is this better? So what is the advantage of looking on those functions x to the n over the characteristic functions. Good, and of course the point is that if I'm summing over powers of eigenvalues, this can be expressed in terms of the entries by actually using the trace. So let us see precisely what this is. So first of all, of course, we are looking on self-adjoint matrices. So our matrices, so let me just look on any self-adjoint matrix. This is self-adjoint. And then, of course, we know that we can diagonalize it. Any self-adjoint matrix, we can diagonalize it. We can bring it in a diagonal form where the eigenvalues are on a diagonal. So this means A is diagonalizable. So this means we can write it in the form that A is U du star. So U is a unitary. So with the help of a change of the basis, we can bring it to a diagonal form. So D is here a diagonal. So first U is unitary. So this means U times U star is the identity, and also the other way around. And the D, of course, is diagonal. So D is diagonal. And what do we have on the diagonals? Exactly the eigenvalues. With D is our n by n matrix, where I have the eigenvalues. And with multiplicity, I have exactly n eigenvalues, which I show up on the diagonal. Good, but then, of course, we can write the sum over the powers of the eigenvalues with the help of this. And so, of course, we are interested in the powers of the eigenvalues. D contains the eigenvalues. And of course, if I take the nth power of D, I just get here the power there. But this is actually the same as the diagonalization of A to the n. So namely, A to the n, if I multiply A with itself n times, and I'm using this, then of course, I mean, I'm multiplying things. I get here U star times a U, because it's unitary, all those go away, and I'm only left with a U at the beginning and a U star at the end. So, and of course, and then I'm just multiplying these n times. So this is U times D to the n times U star, where of course D to the n contains now the nth powers of the eigenvalues on the diagonal. So this is lambda 1 to the n up to lambda capital N to the n. Okay, so this means the U does not only diagonalize the A, but also powers of the A. But then, of course, we can write, so what do we want? We want the average over the nth power of the eigenvalues, but those are exactly the guys which I have here in the diagonal. So how do I get the sum of those guys? I take just the trace of this. So this means that if I want to take the sum over the lambda I to the power n, summing from 1 to capital N, this is nothing else than the trace of d to the n. And of course, in this form, this is not very useful because the d contains the eigenvalues, which we don't know. But of course, under the trace, we can now go back to the a. I mean, the a is the guy which we know quite well. And in particular, the trace is unitarily invariant. So this is the same as if I multiply here with a u, then a d to the n, and here with the u star. Because the trace, essentially, I can bring this u star to the beginning. U star u is equal to 1, so it goes away. So the trace of this is the same as the trace of this, but u dn u star is a to the n. And now I'm back to the a, so what I have here is now the trace of a to the n. And this is now something which is much better to deal with. Because, I mean, now this is just, I mean, taking a trace of a matrix is somehow easy. Taking powers of a matrix is also okay if I know the entries of the matrix. So here I don't have to know anything about the eigenvalues. Of course, they are somewhere in the background. But essentially, the knowledge I need are the entries of A. Okay, and so you see that's the reason why it's good to go over to this d to the n. Of course, with the characteristic function, I couldn't do this. I cannot say. I mean, if I want the characteristic function, of an interval, I don't a priori I don't know which function this is of the eigenvalues. It's a very complicated function which I cannot control. Okay, but for the power, it's a very easy function in terms of the eigenvalues. So this means what I'm really interested in is this sum divided by n. So what I have is that this normalization of this lambda I to the power n, summing over all eigenvalues, is 1 over n times the trace of a to the n. Okay, and you see we always have this factor 1 over n, because somehow we are normalizing things, and so it's also good, instead of using the usual trace, which is the sum over the diagonal, we take the normalized version. And I'm going to denote this by a little tr. That's our normalized trace. Which is in particular good if we want to send n to infinity. Because the ordinary trace of the unit matrix is n, which of course explodes if n goes to infinity. If I normalize it, the normalized trace of the unit matrix is always 1, which has a nice limit if n goes to infinity. Good. Okay, so maybe let me introduce this notation. And actually I called this chapter last time chapter 0, which maybe is stupid, so I change it to chapter 1. Okay, so maybe you should change all the numbers. So it's actually 1.10. Good, so first this notation that we denote by little tr, just the normalization of the capital tr, of the normalized trace, of the trace. Okay, so this is tr. Of our matrices. So this means, just write it down again explicitly, so the trace of any matrix, this normalized trace of any n by n matrix, ij from 1 up to n, is the sum over the diagonal terms in a matrix, but normalized by 1 over n, by 1 over the size of the matrix. So this is by definition 1 over n, the sum over aii. Over the diagonal. Good. Okay, and so what we have seen with this calculation is that what we are claiming now, what we have to show if we want to prove the Wigner semicircle, so to prove what we see in our histograms, modulo all the things which I told you, but so what we are claiming and what we have to prove is that we have typically for our matrices to see that the averaged powers of the eigenvalues, but this is the same as the normalized trace of the power, so we have to see that these normalized traces of my matrix to some power n converges for n going to infinity to the corresponding moment of the semicircle distribution. Okay, so that's now a more mathematical statement, but first of all it's still kind of wrong, because we should normalize things so that we really converge, and it might also not be clear how we formalize typically. Of course, it means that in more or less all the pictures, the generic pictures which we do, we should see this behavior, but of course we also have to formalize this in a mathematical way. Good, but maybe first we should think about the scaling. Of course, if the matrices which I had up to now, I have not really scaled, and they will not converge. So I mean, I really should scale them. And so we have essentially one choice which we can make. We want that all the traces converges, and so the first moment is zero, this of course converges, but the second moment actually, for the matrices which we have used, does not converge, so we should also divide by something so that it converges. So we have one choice we can make, so that the second moment converges, but then everything is fixed, and then all the others should also converge. But let us think, what is the scaling which we should use? So choice of the scaling Yeah, so we should note that we have to do scaling. So note that we need to choose the right scaling in N. We need to choose the right scaling in N for the existence of a limit N going to infinity. For the existence of the limit N goes to infinity. Oh, so namely, and of course this depends on the matrices which you consider, but I mean what we considered up to now were matrices where the entries were plus and minus one. Oh, so let us look for this kind of matrices how we should normalize them. So for the case for which I showed you the pictures also last time, so for the case where all the entries of my matrices are just chosen between plus and minus one, so essentially making a coin throw for each entry apart from the symmetry condition, we can of course, for example, calculate the second moment. The second moment is the easiest moment, which in this case we can write down very explicitly, and of course this should converge. And so we should choose the scaling in such a way that the second moment converges, and then hopefully everything else, I mean, then we don't have any freedom anymore. Then the rest must also converge if things are nice. Okay, but we have one freedom which we take for looking on the second moment. So let me write down the second moment of our matrix. So what is this? I mean, the little tr is a normalized trace, so I should take 1 over n. And then I should take the trace of an squared. So I should take the matrix, the product of an with itself. And of course, the ii entry of this product is aij aji. So if I'm summing over j, then this is just the product of this guy. And then taking the trace means this index should be the same as this. And I'm also summing over this. So I'm just summing here from 1 to n in this way over the entries. So the summation over j is matrix multiplication. The summation over I is taking the trace. And because I take the normalized trace, I'm dividing by 1 over n. That's what this here really means in terms of the entries. And now, of course, because our matrix is self-adjoint, the entry at the position ji is the adjoint of the entry at the position ij. We only have real entries, so it's just the same. So the aji is the same as the aij. And then, of course, I have there, for each I and j, I have there just the square of aij. So this means, so this guy here, so we are summing over all I and j, but for each I and j, aij is the same as a, so aji is the same as aij, and then I have here aij squared. So what I have here is aij squared, but aij is either plus or minus one, but if I square plus or minus one, I always get one. So independent of what aij is, it's always 1, which means I'm just summing here over 1. So all those guys are 1s, and I'm summing how many terms? I'm summing n squared terms, because I and j are running from 1 to n, so I have n squared terms, and I'm dividing by 1 over n. So I have 1 over n, and each term is n squared, each term is 1, and I have n squared terms, so it's n squared. So what I have here is actually n. So this means a normalized trace of A squared for all our matrices is actually the same, namely it's equal to N. And this means, of course, I should better divide my matrix by 1 over the square root, because here I have the square, so that this is normalized to 1. This means I'm replacing, instead of looking on a matrix where the entries are plus minus 1, I'm looking on matrices where the entries are plus minus 1 over square root of n. Because then I'm sure that the second moment is 1, so it has a limit. And then we have to check what happens with all the other moments. Good. And of course here it's very special that the second moment does not depend on the matrix which I consider. For higher moments, of course, the value of the trace of A to the 4 or A to the 6 will depend on the actually chosen matrix. Here it was just because it's so simple, because the result is always here equal 1. In general, of course, if I'm multiplying more of them, it will not always be the same. Good, but in any case, at least the second moment has to converge. So, since this has to converge for n to infinity, so at the moment it's n, we should rescale our matrices. So I should change the n to 1, which means I should divide the matrix by a square root of n, because then the square is divided by n. Okay, so we should rescale our matrices that the an, which I had before, is replaced by 1 over the square root of an. Or maybe more precisely, we consider now the matrices An, and maybe I'm writing down the 1 over square root of n explicitly, and then I'm still writing Aij, where the Aijs are plus minus 1 as before. I and j is going from 1 up to n, where Aij is plus minus 1. Okay, and then with this scaling, of course, we just have seen that the second moment converges to 1, which of course is the second moment of the semicircle. But then what we are claiming is that then also automatically all the higher moments also converge to the corresponding higher moments of the semicircle, which a priori is absolutely not clear why this should be the case. So this is really a kind of statement which is not obvious and which we have to prove. So for this scaling, we claim now that we have typically now that also all the higher moments converge to the corresponding semicircle quantity. So that typically the trace of our matrix, of our n by n matrix to the power little n, converges if the size of the matrix goes to infinity to the nth moment of Wigner semicircle. And at the moment, okay, I mean, we are calling this semicircle, but I mean, we are claiming there exists a deterministic measure, probability measure, such that we converge to the moments. So here for deterministic probability measure mu w. And of course, that was somehow the surprising thing, that here this is random. We have many matrices which we produce, but typically, so most of them show the same eigenvalue distribution for n large. And this is this guy. Good. And maybe now I should give you maybe more precisely, I mean, first of all, maybe the formula. I mean, if I want to prove this, I should know what this side here is. Okay, and of course, in the picture we have seen the density looks like a semicircle, and you can write down an explicit density for this. That's what we are going to do, and we call it a semicircle. And then, of course, we should know what are the moments of this guy, because that's what we have here. And I mean, this is actually something which you should do on the first assignment. So, I mean, I'm just writing down the statement. But to prove them, that was your task in the first assignment. So it's now more fixing the notation and really writing down precisely what the semicircular distribution is and in particular what its moments are. Okay, so first the definition maybe of the semicircle. So what is precisely this distribution which we get in a limit? So we call it a semicircle distribution because somehow the shape somehow looks like a semicircle. And of course, it's normalized so that the second moment is one. So maybe we call it a standard semicircle distribution. Which means we have normalized it for the second moment, but usually we are in this normalization. So the semicircle distribution, which usually I denote by mu, maybe a subscript w, actually for Wigner, because Wigner observed this. So what is this? This is a measure on the real line, and it lives on, in this normalization, on a compact interval, namely the interval from -2 to +2. A measure on the interval from -2 to +2, and it actually is a measure which has a density. So it's really a very nice measure, and I'm writing down the density. The density is the semicircle. So it's a measure on this. With density, so the density of this guy is given by 1 over 2 pi, and then the semicircle is 4 minus x squared dx. So this means it's a density living from -2 to +2, and the shape is somehow a kind of semicircle distribution. Of course, whether it's really a semicircle or semi-ellipse, of course, depends on the scaling which I do in this direction. And so, of course, at zero, it just here, the value here is 1 over 2 pi. And of course, this here is chosen in such a way that this is a probability measure, so that the integral over this guy is 1. So that's the distribution, but actually what we are claiming here is something for which we should know the moments of this distribution, and the proof is according to the moments. So this concrete form maybe is not even so important. What is really important is to know what are the moments of this guy, and those are very famous numbers. They are so-called Catalan numbers. So as part two of this definition, I'm defining the Catalan numbers. And then I'm writing down the statement that those are actually the numbers, the moments of the semicircle, and these are the things which you had to prove in the assignment. So the Catalan numbers, denoted by CK, so this is a sequence of numbers, they are given by, and I'm giving now them in an explicit form. So you can write them down very explicitly. So the Catalan numbers given by, so CK is 1 over K plus 1, and then the binomial coefficient 2K choose K. So it's a very easy binomial kind of expression. And so this is a sequence of numbers, and maybe, so C0 is 1, C1 is 1, and then it goes on with 2, 5, 14, 42, 132, and so on. So it's very concrete sequence of numbers, but maybe it's for many purposes it's better to describe this sequence by number by a recursion which it satisfies. So, and those description I want to collect in the theorem. So first of all about the Catalan numbers, first part, and then the second part will be that the moments of the semicircle are the Catalan numbers. But first those numbers, I mean those numbers show up in many contexts in combinatorics and many things. I mean they are numbers which count many different things. Okay, so there's a book by Stanley where he has 200 exercises about things where you should show that those guys are counted by the Catalan numbers. So it's really one of the most important numbers in combinatorics, sequence of numbers. Okay, and maybe important thing is that the Catalan number satisfies some recursion. So the Catalan numbers satisfy a quadratic recursion. The recursion that CK is given by CL times CK minus L minus 1, where L is running from 0 to K minus 1. So for any K, let's say greater or equal than 1, you're summing here over smaller Catalan numbers. The L is here strictly smaller than the K, and also this quantity is smaller. So this is really a recursion which expresses one Catalan number in terms of smaller ones. Okay, and this means, of course, if you also know the first Catalan number, C0, then this determines things uniquely. But because, I mean, this is trivial but important observation, that if you see this recursion, and maybe you know C0 is equal to 1, then you know that you have the Catalan numbers. Okay, and I mean, many problems are counted by the Catalan numbers because the problems have a kind of recursive structure which corresponds to this decomposition here. Okay, and we will see such things later. But so the first statement is that the Catalan numbers are uniquely determined by this recursion. And of course, you need at least one initial value by the initial value, let's say the zeros Catalan number, which is equal to 1. Good. Okay, and then of course, maybe it's not clear a priori that those numbers here satisfy this recursion. That's more or less the content of this one exercise which you should do, that actually those numbers are really satisfy this. And I mean, if you plug it in directly, it's not obvious. So the exercise is going via generating functions. So the exercise shows you essentially how you see that this is a solution for this. Okay, but usually this explicit expression for the Catalan numbers usually is not so important, because usually what drives everything forward is this recursion. And that's very often how you recognize that you have the Catalan numbers, because you see that you have numbers which satisfy this recursion. Good. And of course, we will come back and we will see later specific things which they count. But now, at the moment, it's important for us, the relevance of those numbers is that actually they are also the moments of the semicircle distribution. So that's the second part of the statement which I want to make. And this is also something which you should prove in the assignments. Yeah, so the second part is, so first of all, of course, the semicircle should be a probability measure, because I mean, we want to get it as a limit of the counting of the relative ratios of our histograms, and this should be a probability measure. So this means I should have chosen the 1 over 2 pi in the right way. So namely, this should be a probability measure, so maybe that's the first part of the statement. That I mean, I said it's a measure, but of course it's a probability measure. So the semicircle distribution mu w is a probability measure, which means of course if I integrate over everything, which means in this case from minus 2 to 2, then of course I should get 1. So this means 1 over 2 pi, the integral from minus 2 to plus 2 over this density 4 minus x squared integrated with respect to x should be 1. Or that this integral is 2 pi, which is somehow clear if you think that this really describes half of a disk. Good. Okay, and then maybe the more interesting thing is what are the moments? And of course you see, I mean, this would be essentially, this is the same as C0. So this one here corresponds to this one. Okay, and this one here corresponds to the second moment. Of course it is clear the semicircle is a symmetric distribution, so all its odd moments are zero. Okay, so it's only the even moments which are there, and I'm claiming those here are the even moments of the semicircle. So this is the zero moment. This is the first moment. We have made the, in our matrices, the normalization. The second moment is equal to 1. And this is, I'm also claiming this, and those are all the other ones. And so I'm claiming here that this is actually the relation between the semicircle and the Catalan numbers. So its moments, the moments of the semicircle, are given by, so the moments, just explicitly, so what is this? This is I'm integrating x to the n with respect to my probability measure, so with respect to my density, 4 minus x, dx on the interval from minus 2 to plus 2, and I'm claiming that this, okay, in the odd case is 0, this is trivial because the density is symmetric, so this is 0 for n odd. But if n is even, so let's say I'm writing n as 2k, then actually I get the kth Catalan number, ck. Good. Yeah, and this is one of the assignments which you should prove. So this is important because it really shows you what is, I mean, the meaning of the semicircle distribution. Because we are going to prove things with the help of the Catalan numbers. Good. So what, I mean, we have now formulated somehow our statement. So namely, we want to show, we are claiming that typically the traces, normalized traces of powers of our random matrices converge to the Catalan numbers. Okay, but still, maybe I should say, what do I mean with typically? Or I mean, how do we prove this? Okay, so this is a kind of the type of convergence which we now should talk about. Yeah, let me take this away. So we are claiming that traces of the powers of our matrices converge to the Catalan numbers. But in which sense do I claim this? Because our matrices are kind of random objects, or we have many matrices. And it's clear not all of them converge to the Catalan numbers. There are always atypical ones which have a totally different behavior. And so what we are saying is that many of them are very close to the Catalan numbers. We have to make this precise, I mean, we have to formulate this, and we also have to see, in particular, how to prove such things. So, we should talk a bit about the type of convergence and what we actually mean with such phrases that typically we have this kind of convergence. So this is the type of convergence. So let me still again write down this phrase which I'm saying. So namely, so we are claiming that typically so we have the convergence of the trace of, let's say, an squared converges to 1. And of course, for our example, this is really very typically because we know that for all of our matrices, this is actually equal to 1 for all n. Okay, but of course, we're also claiming that for higher powers, this also converges. So the fourth moment should converge to 2. That's the next Catalan number. Then the sixth moment should converge to 5. Next Catalan number. And trace of a to the power 8 should go to 14. The trace of a to the 10 should go to 42. And so on. Okay. And of course, those guys, it's not so clear what do we mean with typically. So, but what do we mean with typically? And, okay, maybe the direct mathematical word for this would be almost surely. Okay, so in principle we mean is this almost surely, but almost surely is a thing which is not so easy to grasp, so I want to replace this for now by something which is intuitively much better, namely convergence in probability. And maybe we talk about almost surely later, or convergence in probability is maybe enough, because this is really what we see in these pictures. Okay, so the mathematical word, or the strongest kind of convergence, would be almost sure for this is almost surely, but let us for now restrict or just look on the convergence which is called convergence in probability. But let us for now look on the more intuitive convergence in probability. For our powers of the traces. So an, let's say, to the power 2k converges to ck. That's what we want to see. I mean, the odd powers are all zero anyhow. So for the odd powers, there's nothing to prove because they are all zero. So they also converge to zero. They are not for all matrices. They are even for the odd powers, there would be something to prove, because not all matrices are the eigenvalue distribution of the matrix is not symmetric, because we have the matrices where all the entries are plus one, and of course then also odd powers are not zero. Okay, so it's also there would also be a statement for the odd powers, but let me concentrate on this now. So what do I mean with convergence in probability? With this I'm meaning that the probability of the matrices for which I'm a little bit away from this goes to zero. And the probability, of course, I mean here we have a finite number of matrices, so with probability of course I just mean the ratio of matrices which don't show this behavior. So precisely. So let me denote by omega n, let's say, the set of our matrices of our considered matrices, and for us this is a finite set for each n, no? Because it's the matrices where the entries are plus minus 1, normalized by the square root of n. Huh? So omega n in our case now are matrices A n, which are of the form 1 over square root of n, and then I have the entries Aij, Aj from 1 to n, such that A n is self-adjoint, and the entries Aij are either plus or minus 1. Okay, yeah. So this is a finite set. I mean, for n, there are 2 to the n times n plus 1 over 2 possibilities for choosing such matrices. Okay, and so what we are saying, matrices from this set, for them we have in probability this kind of behavior, which means that most of the matrices from this set are for large n very close to this guy. So this means then convergence in probability for this means that if I choose an epsilon, then the probability of being further away from epsilon by epsilon from the CK goes to zero. So this means that for any epsilon bigger than zero, if I'm looking on a probability of the ANs for which I have that the trace of AN to the 2K minus CK, so the claim is this goes to this, so it should, so if I have a situation where the distance is larger than epsilon, this should not happen too often. And so I'm claiming that this probability for fixed epsilon goes to zero if I'm sending n to infinity. And what do I mean here with probability? Of course, I mean I have here a discrete space of matrices, so each matrix has the same probability. So this just means the matrices. Here I'm counting just the matrices for which this is the case. And then I'm dividing by the number of all matrices. So this here just means the number of matrices in my set omega n for which the normalized trace of An to the power 2k minus ck, so for which the distance between those two guys is bigger than epsilon, divided by the total number of guys, of matrices which I consider. So so I'm saying that the ratio of the matrices which are not close to ck goes to zero. So that's what I mean with convergence in probability. And I mean that's also on the level of the histograms, it's also the same. I'm saying that I have a limit shape, this Wigner semicircle, and then for large n, I'm saying that most of the matrices are very close to this limit shape. The histogram of the matrices for most of them are close to this. Okay, and I mean, of course, one has to specify what do I mean with close. Here I'm just talking about the traces of powers, so these are just numbers. So this just means the difference is bigger than epsilon if they are not close. Okay, good. But now, of course, the question is, okay, so this is now a precise mathematical formulation of what we want to prove, but of course there is a question, how can we prove such thing? Okay, and the proof of this now is actually that we are weakening this. I mean, proving this directly is not so easy, because for this we would somehow have to know. I mean, it's hard to count or to say which are the matrices for which are close to this. Okay. So what we are going to do is we prove actually this in average. So we show that in an average sense things are close to this, and then we are going to use this kind of concentration phenomena, which says that most matrices are close to their average. So we are splitting the problem into two things, and first we will only talk about the average behavior, and then later we will see that we have this concentration in high dimension, which also gives us then things like this. Yeah, but so maybe let me write this down. I mean, we have our matrices. Our matrices where the entries are plus and minus one, and we have a lot of different matrices, and it's hard to control them. It's not. Yeah, we cannot really talk about single matrices. It's hard to say anything specific for a single matrix. The idea is, of course, most of the matrices should show a similar behavior. But how do we talk about typical matrices? And what we do first, we talk about the average behavior. Averaging over things is always much simpler than talking about specific events. So I mean the randomness. I mean up to now I have not really used randomness. I'm using a kind of probabilistic language by saying, of course, I want to see how many matrices have this behavior. But now we use a little bit of probabilistic ideas that actually is a good thing which we should do. And I mean averaging really helps. It makes the calculation much simpler. It's easier to calculate average quantities than really to calculate very specific situations. And this is the reason that first we will replace this by the average problem, which we really can deal with very much more directly and very easily. And then later we will see that actually because of concentration, the difference between the averaged value and the typical value is going to zero if n is getting large. So the point is, so how can we show, let's see this thing here, which we in principle want to prove, this convergence in probability. How can we show this? And we split this problem into two parts, that first we show a weaker statement, but which is actually much easier to show. So first we show a weaker form of convergence, namely convergence in average. And what do I mean with this? So what do I show there? There I show that that if I averaging over all my matrices, then these traces of powers goes to the corresponding Catalan number. So this means I'm averaging, so I'm taking the average, which I denote by E. So I take E of the normalized trace of An to the power 2k. And then I want to show that this goes for n to infinity to this. So if I'm averaging over this, this is just a number now. There's no randomness anymore. And the average in our case, what is this? This means I'm just taking the traces of the powers for my matrices, and I'm doing this for all matrices. And I sum over all of them and divide by their number. So I just average over all possible values of this trace. So this is just, I'm summing over all matrices in my ensemble of matrices and take for each of them the trace of An to the 2k, and then I just divide by the number of the matrices which I have. So I take the averaged value of this guy here. And the point, of course, is calculating such averages. For this, I do not really have to look on each of the matrices. I just can use that I know I'm summing here over matrices which have a lot of symmetry in them. So I mean, this sum here I can do by some other means. Of course, I'm not. I mean, each of these quantities is hard to access, but the average quantity, that's much much better. Good. Okay, but then of course this is a priori weaker. I mean, if I have a distribution of a random variable, of course, knowing the average is much less information than knowing the whole distribution. But the point in high dimension with this concentration is that actually in the high dimension, our distribution, they will become sharper and sharper, and they will essentially be just around the expectation value. This is this concentration phenomena where we will also talk about, but that's the second part. But this is a more theoretical part which tells us that the difference between the average value and the general behavior goes to zero. And there, I mean, in this part, we really don't see what the limit is. I mean, here we really have to calculate the limit, the Catalan numbers. The second part just tells us that this convergence here actually is stronger by more abstract reasons. But it doesn't tell us anything anymore about the Catalan numbers. Good, so the second step is we show that with high probability the deviation from the average will become small if the size of the matrix goes to infinity. So the deviation from the average will become small as n goes to infinity. Oh, okay, and of course we will talk about this later, but first we will consider step one, because this is really the step where we also see how the Catalan numbers and the semicircle arise, because there we really have to calculate what are the moments in the limit. Okay, maybe only an averaged form of convergence, but then the second step will improve this. So we will first consider step one. And so, and this is more or less the proof of the Wigner semicircle law, and it will take us maybe 2 weeks or so to really do this. And then later in the second step we will show step two, and this is this kind of concentration phenomena, which says roughly that in high dimensions, things are usually very close to their average value. And we will treat this later. Treat it later. Good. Maybe let me make a final remark in this context, that actually this kind of convergence, namely this convergence that traces in the matrices converge to moments of the limiting object, is actually a statement about convergence of measures, because these traces and those stuff in terms of the matrices can also be seen as integration with respect to a measure. So what we are really talking about here is really a convergence about measures. So maybe I just want to point this out in the next remark. And later, when we have to understand more theoretically, in particular this relation between a convergence for the characteristic functions and for the powers, that this is the same. I mean, this is in the context of dealing with convergence of measures. So we should see that maybe this here really is about convergence of measures. So note that, so this relation, which we wanted to prove, actually was, I have for some functions, I want to show that this function applied to lambda I, summing from 1 up to n, that this goes for n to infinity to the integral of this function with respect to the semicircle, but this actually is about convergence of measures. Of course, here we see a measure, here we have the semicircle, but maybe here it's not so clear, there's no measure maybe directly there, but actually we can also write this in terms of a measure. So this is actually a statement on convergence of measures. So namely, this side here we can also write as integrating with respect to some measure. And which measure is this? This is the measure which puts mass 1 over n on each of the eigenvalues of my matrix. Which is what we call the eigenvalue distribution of the matrix. So I mean, up to now I have essentially talked about the eigenvalues of a matrix as just a set of numbers, the set of eigenvalues, but you can encode this information in a measure by just saying, okay, I consider the measure where I put mass 1 over n on each of the eigenvalues. That's the same information, but encoded as a measure, and actually quantities which I consider are integration with respect to this measure. Yeah, so namely, this 1 over n, the sum from 1 up to n, f lambda I, is nothing else than integrating f of x with respect to measure, let's say mu a of x, where this mu a is a measure, a discrete measure, which has just n atoms, and I'm putting mass 1 over n on each of the atoms, and the atoms are sitting at the eigenvalues of the matrix. So this is 1 over n times the delta at lambda plus 1 plus delta at lambda n. So this is a Dirac measure, which puts just the mass 1 at this guy here. So with this factor, it puts mass 1 over n on each of the lambda n's. And that's what we call the eigenvalue distribution of the matrix A. So for each self-adjoint matrix, I can encode the information about the eigenvalues in a measure, if I like. And of course, it's a good idea to do this, because quantities I'm interested in are given of this form, but actually they are integrals with respect to this measure. So it makes sense. And then, of course, you see that on this side, I can also write it in terms of this measure, and then this is really about the convergence of measures. And so for this, there are tools, and we are going to develop them, kind of transforms, which allow to control convergence of measures. So this means this here actually can be rewritten. So hence, this convergence here in this language says that the integral over a function f of x d mu a, or maybe I should put here a n, that this converges if n goes to infinity to the integral over f of x d mu, the semicircle. And so this is a kind of, we ask this for a class of functions of f, and this is actually a convergence of the measure mu n to the measure mu. So if we require this for sufficiently many f, this is a kind of convergence that my measures mu a n converge to the measure, the semicircle in the limit. And this means, in particular, the question is, for which f do I need this? So I said we want it for the characteristic functions. We can do it for the powers. And so point will be to see that this is actually the same. So that you can take different classes. If the classes are big enough, they give you this kind of convergence. And for this convergence, we will later develop tools, namely a Cauchy or Stieltjes transform, which allow us to deal with such convergence of measures. And they will also allow us to see that this transition from characteristic functions to the moments is valid. But this will be later. At the moment I will start next few classes with more combinatorial methods, which means calculating the traces of the powers. This is more kind of combinatorial endeavor, and it's more about the entries of the matrices. But later, we need more analytic tools for really being able to understand this convergence better. So we'll come back to such things. Maybe I just want to write it down at the moment that the crucial analytic tool for dealing with this is a Cauchy or Stieltjes transform, which is like a Fourier transform, but which is more adapted to the context of random matrices. So we will need to understand such convergence of measures better and will later develop tools, and those tools are essentially a Cauchy transform or Stieltjes transform. This is more or less the same object. In different communities, it's just called differently, or the difference is a minus sign. So it's either called Cauchy transform or Stieltjes transform. So we will need to understand such convergence better, and we will later develop tools like Cauchy or Stieltjes transform to deal with them. Good, so this means that our first goal, I mean, this analytic stuff will come later. So what we are now really going at is trying to see that the moments of our random matrices converge to the semicircle. But maybe I want to again to show you some pictures just to make clear what I have written at the blackboard is this difference maybe between the typical behavior and the behavior on average, what we are going to do. Again, just some histograms. Good. Anyhow, this doesn't. Okay, so maybe just again. So we are looking on n by n matrices where the entries are plus minus one. I'm ignoring the normalization here at the moment. And yeah, so the point is. Okay, so here, for small n, of course, there are not many matrices. So for 2 by 2 matrices, there are 8 matrices, which we consider, and I have put them all here. So that's the 8 matrices, which have entries plus minus 1 and which are symmetric. Okay, and of course, they have eigenvalues. Each of them has 2. And I mean, the two first one have eigenvalues 0 and 2. The next two have minus 2 and 0. And of those four guys, they have minus square root of 2 and plus square root of 2. And so I can, for each of them, I can draw the histogram. So the first two matrices have the histogram with those two eigenvalues. The next two have those histogram. And the last four, so each of them has this histogram with two eigenvalues. Okay, now what we are really to do now is not look on typical pictures like this, but average over all of them, which means I take all the 8 matrices and average over all the eigenvalues. So you see I'm just adding essentially all the histograms and rescale it. So you see, I mean, I have this eigenvalue 0 here appears 4 times because I have it in each of those 4 matrices. This guy here appears also 4 times because it in each of those 4 matrices, but this here is only appears 2 times. So you see this here is the average eigenvalue distribution. So here essentially I have 16 eigenvalues because I take all the matrices, each of them has 2, and I put them all together. And that's what we are going to talk about if I'm talking about the averaged eigenvalue distribution. What we really want to understand is somehow typical pictures. But of course, for small n, you see, of course, typical pictures don't say much, and also the average one doesn't say so much. But if I'm going with bigger one, let's say 4 by 4 matrices, so then, okay, I have here 2 realizations. I have not written down the matrix, but okay, I took just one matrix with plus minus 1, another matrix with plus minus 1, so each of them has 4 eigenvalues, and then again I can average, and actually there are 2 to the 10 1024 matrices, 4x4 matrices, which have this plus minus 1 in a symmetric way. And again, I can average over all the eigenvalue distributions, and then you see this contains the average over all 4x4 matrices with plus minus 1 entries. And you already see some structure. I mean, there is somehow more structure than in any of them. And of course, this and this is not very close together. Okay, but the point is, if n is getting bigger, I mean, of course, we get more structure here, and of course we also get more structure here. Here we get more structure much faster, but the point is, of course, that the structure here, the typical structure here and the typical structure there for large n will be the same. Okay, so here is, for example, 10 by 10 matrices. Again, one realization, another realization. Each of them has 10 eigenvalues, where you don't see much. And then I have averaged, but now, I mean, there are really many matrices. So I have 2 to the 5 times 11 matrices, so 2 to the 55, which is okay. So when I now say averaging, of course, I'm not averaging over all of them, because this is much too much, but I'm just taking a lot of them. I produce randomly many of them and add up all their histograms. So here I took 50,000 of those 4x4 matrices, generated in a random way and averaged over them. And now you see, here you get something which is already shows the shape of the semicircle. So even for 10 by 10 matrices, if you average, you are not so far away from semicircle. Of course, here, you don't see the semicircle. I mean, these are just 10 eigenvalues, and there you cannot see a semicircle structure. Good, but then let's say 100 by 100, then the typical behavior already gets closer to the semicircle. And if we average, and now we should average over 2 to the, even the exponent is quite big, 50 times 101. So it's always n times n plus 1 divided by 2, the exponent. So here I took 1,000 over which I averaged. So I took 1,000 random pictures like this and averaged over them. And you see here you are almost at the semicircle. And of course, the typical pictures are not so far away. Okay, and then for 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, then actually one realization is already more or less the semicircle, and you don't see much differences between one realization and another realization, which means if you average, then also, I mean, it's really the semicircle, and on the other hand, it's very close to this. So what we are going to prove now is this picture here, that if we average over our matrices, then we see the semicircle if n is large. And then later, we provide arguments that for a typical matrix, this picture here is very close to this picture, typically. So this means the majority, huge majority of all the matrices have more or less the same picture as this guy. But this is concentration phenomena, that this picture is more or less the same as this picture. For this, we need some more. I mean, essentially, we have to control the fluctuations of your distribution, that this goes to zero. But what we can do, what we will do next few lectures, is to prove this behavior by averaging. And it's really the nice point of, I mean, randomness really helps you to do calculations. That's maybe the thing which one really should be aware of. It's good to have randomness, because averaging is usually much easier than doing concrete calculations. If you have many possibilities, and each of these possibilities is maybe, it's not so easy to deal with. If you want to do with the averaged behavior, very often this can be done much easier. And that's what we are going to do. And then, of course, in small dimensions, usually the average behavior and the actual behavior can be quite far apart. But in high dimensions, very often the typical behavior and the average behavior are very close. And that's what is going to happen here. So there are a few lessons which we can learn from this, so that we can do the calculation here, but also that we have abstract tools which tells us that this here is more or less the same as this here. Good. Okay, so that's the pictures which we want to deal with, and okay, maybe, I will then start with looking on how do we calculate the average behavior. And so now, up to now, for my pictures, I used essentially matrices where I chose plus minus 1 as entries. This is nice. because there are only finitely many matrices, and maybe it's easy to think about it, but actually for averaging purposes, it's not so straightforward to average here. And actually there is an ensemble which is much easier, namely when I'm taking Gaussian distributed entries. This is from a mathematical point of view much easier to deal with, and that's what we are going to do first. So instead of looking on the matrices where the entries are plus minus one, I will now look on the so-called Gaussian random matrices where the entries are distributed according to the Gaussian distribution. Because averaging over Gaussian variables is somehow has a lot of structure. Is somehow easier than averaging over binary plus minus variables. Good. Okay, so that's what I want to do. So maybe I should now, of course, tell you also something about the Gaussian distribution and how to average over this. So maybe start a little bit with this now. Maybe let me first remark this transition that it's easier to do things with Gaussian random matrices, and then I will tell you something about the Gaussian distribution and what we can do with it, in particular how we can average over Gaussian random variables. So this is now section two about Gaussian random matrices. And we are going to prove in the averaged sense the Wigner semicircle for those matrices which have those guys as entries. So this is about, so they are called Gaussian random matrices. And they are the nicest ensemble of matrices where we can do a lot of calculations very explicitly. Okay, and the main formula which tells us how to average over Gaussian variables is the so-called Wick formula. So I will tell you what the Wick formula is. And with the help of this, we can calculate the averages over traces of powers of our Gaussian random matrices. And then get enough understanding of those powers to get a proof of the semicircle. And this is mostly combinatorial. So the Wick formula is a kind of combinatorial interpretation of moments. So this gives us a combinatorial proof of Wigner's semicircle. Good. So let me first recall again what we want to do. So we want to prove the convergence of our random matrices to the semicircle by showing the following. So we want to prove it by showing that the moments converge. And we want to show it in average sense. So what we want to look at is the average over the moments of the matrices, which are the traces of An, let's say to 2k. And this average quantity, if n goes to infinity, should go to the Catalan numbers, to the ck. So those ck, those are the Catalan numbers. Good, okay. As I said, averaging is something which is usually nice, but I mean, here if I have matrices where the entries are plus minus one, it's not so easy. So it becomes easier if I'm looking on other matrices where the entries are Gaussian random variables. So I will go over to this. So but let's first say, so up to now, our matrices where of the form that an is 1 over square root of n, a normalization, and then I have here aij, which don't really depend on n, but are just plus minus 1s. So ij from 1 up to n with the aij are plus minus 1s. Okay, and from an analytic, but also a combinatorial point of view, it's easier to take another choice of the aij, namely those Gaussian random variables. And yeah, so maybe let me write it down. So from an analytic, but also a combinatorial point of view, it is easier to deal with another choice of the aij. So namely, we take them as Gaussian random variables, or normally distributed random variables. So namely, Gaussian random variables, or Gaussian, often also called normal random variables, but normal has a lot of different meanings in different contexts, so it's more precise to talk about Gaussian random variables. And of course, I mean, so we have to specify how we choose them randomly, so each of the entries we choose as a Gaussian distribution, but then we also have to say how about different entries, and of course we still choose them independently. That was what was also happening for the plus minus one. No? So the choices, we considered all possible choices, which means actually we are choosing them independently, all the entries, up to the symmetry condition. So, random variables. So the different entries and different aij are still, of course, apart from the symmetry, up to the symmetry, so we still want self-adjoint matrices, so what is above the diagonal must show up exactly the same as below the diagonal, so they are still independent. Good, so this means we have now matrices where the entries are independent Gaussian variables, and we want to average traces of powers of such matrices. Of course, traces of powers are functions of all the entries. So we're getting products of the entries, and we have sums over them, and we have to average over them. So this means we have to understand, how do I average over independent Gaussian variables? Because then I can use this for doing it for the specific averaging which I want to do with my random matrices. And so I should now be more precise. Maybe first I really remind you what the standard Gaussian distribution is, how it looks like, but then I tell you also what are its moments. Because we are averaging over product of those guys, we have to understand the moments. And there is a combinatorial understanding of them. That's the Wick formula, that's the crucial thing. So maybe let me just give the definition now, and then about the other things we talk next time. So just I'm ending for today with just the definition of the Gaussian distribution, and again, let's say the standard one, which means the second moment is normalized to 1. So the standard Gaussian, or maybe normal, let's say a random variable, so what is this? And let me for now look on real valued ones. Later we will also consider complex valued one, but here this is a real valued Gaussian. So this is a real valued Gaussian random variable. And standard means mean zero. So our guys will usually have mean zero. And then standard means we normalize the variance, which in this case is just a second moment, a 1. And this means just we can write down explicitly its distribution, of course, the Gaussian distribution. So this means our random variable has a distribution, has a distribution which is given by the Gauss distribution. But let me write it down. Explicitly. So let's say I'm giving the probability that I'm taking on values, let's say between t1 and t2. So then my distribution is given by density, so I have to integrate over the interval from t1 to t2 with respect to this density. And the density is 1 over the square root of 2 pi, integrating from t1 to t2, and the density is e to the minus t squared over 2 dt. So that's my Gaussian distribution. Okay, so if I have a random variable which is distributed according to this, this means I'm getting the probability that I'm seeing values between t1 and t2 by this. And of course, if I want to calculate moments of this random variable, I integrate t to the n with respect to this density. Okay, so this means the moments, which is the crucial thing we are interested in, because we want to average over moments. And hence, its moments are given by, so the expectation of x to the n, if x is my Gaussian distributed random variable, is given by integrating with this density 1 over the square root of 2 pi, and then of course integrating over the whole R. I mean, this density of course has no compact support, it's really distributed over all of R, and I'm taking t to the n times e to the minus t squared over 2 dt. So those are the moments. And actually, these integrals can be calculated, and they are very nice numbers. Actually, they are natural numbers, and they are counting some combinatorial objects. And that's I will explain next time. So this is really this combinatorial way that, I mean, of course, in principle, we are doing analysis. We are calculating integrals, we are calculating moments, which are given by integrating with respect to densities here, and then if I go to higher spaces, so it's high-dimensional integrals, but these integrals have a combinatorial meaning. They are counting things, and we are trying to understand this. This will give us a combinatorial approach to the whole thing. Good, but next time I will talk more about this. That's it for today. Thanks.